So there's a place in London, and that's where I am right now, called Acute Art. And it's more of a studio or a laboratory, if you want. It's a relatively small institution, or it's not maybe even an institution. As I say, it's more an atelier. So it's like 10 people working here. And we have been exploring new visual possibilities introduced by very contemporary technologies. I'll just show you this little clip.
In real life, when someone rescues another person or offers aid of any kind, there is a transfer of energy. Will the same happen in a virtual reality? In real life.
So the Moderna Museet in Stockholm actually has a link to a special chapter when it comes to art and technology. There was a thing in the 1960s called Experiments in Art and Technology, EAT. And that was launched in, I think that's wrong, 67. I think it's actually earlier, 66 or so. And it was partly a Swedish project, because the key technician was a man called Billy Cleaver, a Swedish engineer who moved to the US in the 1960s and started to work for a place called Bell Labs. Bell Labs, I think, still exists, and but back then it was the best funded experimental laboratory for new technologies in the world, I think. So working with telephone technologies, and they got very involved with some of that period's most important artists. Some of them were, Robert Rauschenberg was maybe at the center of this, Merce Cunningham, John Cage, of course, even Andy Warhol, I think, marginally. And the whole idea was to see, what happens if important artists get access to technologies that they normally wouldn't have access to. So it was a very experimental thing, and it became visible primarily in the art world, but it became a network that actually grew internationally, and EAT in the end involved hundreds of people. There are a number of books on EAT, and the editor of Art Forum, Michelle Kuo, who just left her job and now joined MoMA, she wrote her 500-page dissertation on this movement, and there are other books, but it's almost an exception from a general skepticism towards new technology in the art world, I would say. We can come back to that, but it was filled with the optimism, and they thought that, if we give artists access to things, to tools that they wouldn't normally have, great things will happen. And not only great things happened, there were lots of kind of boring experiments, and Moderna Museet in Stockholm, is one of the places that has the archives, and we did many shows with these people, and some of the key works are actually in the possession of that museum by Robert Rauschenberg and others. There was a thing called Nine Evenings in 66 in New York. That's a legendary moment, and when people talk about art and technology in the 20th century, they always mention EAT and this Nine Evenings theater and engineering. It happened at the Armory in New York, and it was slightly scandalized or a little bit, underwhelming, I think. Very hyped, but then in the end, people were quite disappointed with this event, because it wasn't visually so overwhelming as maybe people were expecting. And you see the poster there. It's kind of interesting that, now these guys are too small. All the guys with ties are the technicians. Surprise. And then you can see, a few other people, and that is like John Cage and Rauschenberg and a few other people.